Hello, everyone. It's very exciting to be here today. I am going to present our work on fine-tuning large language models for classical mechanics. And just a little bit of a background about myself. I am a final year PhD student with Professor Marin Solicic. Actually, Marin was my undergraduate advisor in physics. So he helped me go through the undergraduate curriculum in physics here in MIT. I'm presenting on behalf of my collaborators as well, Varun, Charlotte, Mohammed, Peter, and Marin. And we all share curiosity in this room. And with my collaborators, we also share a vision that it's very important to research whether we need and can train our own large language models for the classroom and beyond. So I believe my talk is going to complement the discussion we have had so far, and I will venture into posing a fundamental question about whether we can use off-the-shelf models. So this is such as chatGPT. So these are models that are hidden behind an app. We have less control of the weights of these models versus another very interesting direction of large language models that we have discussed since the very first talk, since Professor LeCun's talk about open sourced models, where we might assume we have full control. We have the weights and we can fine tune them in the way we want. And another big question I want to pose is, can we use ChatGPT to help us tutor physics? I would like to point some of the observations that we've had before we venture into our research exploration. First of all, ChatGPT is a general intelligence, which may not be necessarily what we need for the physics classroom. Another observation is that open-sourced large language models are becoming very good. They have been evaluated mostly on mainstream tasks from the internet. But to some degree, they're matching the performance of GPT-4. And we may have some privacy concerns. We may not want to share the problems that we use in the classroom to ChatGPT. We don't want to pollute the training data of these large language models because they may turn out not to be very helpful actually afterwards. We have some hypotheses. First, the hypothesis is that fine-tuning on custom data would make for a better tutor helper. And another hypothesis that we have is that fine-tuning is cheap. So we have this incredible models that have been trained on the whole internet on trillions of tokens, and we assume that there is knowledge there. Now with fine-tuning, our task is how to present that knowledge in the best possible way to help a tutor, but also see if we can come up with interesting combinatorial generalizations of that knowledge. And here you can see a screenshot of undergraduate subjects. This is one of the fundamental classes at MIT, 801, Physics 1, Classical Mechanics. We wanted to focus our exploration, at least at this stage, to classical mechanics. Here is the task. We want to fine-tune an open-source large language model almost as good as ChatGPT. Say we start on 801 data. We want to research what the capabilities of the fine-tuned models are. We don't know whether they'll be useful or not, but we want to at least give the research to figure it out. And of course, a pressing question is, could it actually become a tutor helper for 801? For that purpose, we collected a data set, and we extracted very well-curated questions from 801 edX. So with the help of our collaborators, we have about 1,000 such questions, which is a very solid repository of good quality physics problems. Of course, we also wanted to see what's on the internet, and we found online textbooks repositories. So these were in LaTeX, so we were able to extract 1,000 concept questions, and some of them are also a little bit technical, in order to complement our initial repository of data. The current experiments that we'll see, the current fine-tuning experiments, we are using 2,000 examples to train and 200 examples to evaluate. And we're also very excited about the additional data that we have, but we have not yet used. We have diagrams. As you know, going through the classical mechanics curriculum, using a diagram is an extremely important procedural tool for solving a problem. So we have about 1,000 very well curated diagrams. We have custom textbooks that we are writing ourselves that include about 20 chapters. And additionally, from public data sets on the internet, if we go on Hugging Face, we can download 50,000 examples of concept questions. So we haven't used these yet. And the reason we haven't used them yet is because we want to start very slowly in our exploration. We want to do very controlled experiments. And of course, because we have some challenges. Let's dig into the challenges. First of all, we are not currently using diagrams when we talk to ChatGPT. We want to figure out an efficient way to use such diagrams. We have only a few data points. So a very natural question in training neural networks is, can we actually learn something new from just 2,000 examples? So this is a very pressing question. Also, we have been fine-tuning these models on a very limited compute. We have 8 GPUs, old GPUs, and this means that the examples that we feed into the large language model are gonna have limited context, so they're just gonna contain about 50 to 100 words. And also, the size of the model is very limited. Another very important challenge is that it's very hard to evaluate what we are learning, what the model has learned. We most of the times have to rely on human evaluation because checking whether somebody understands physics is a very hard problem, at least for now. Here at the top corner, I'm presenting an example. So you probably cannot read this, but you don't need to. I'm just gonna give you, just gonna start talking about it. A person is standing on top of a hill. There's some parameters such as the angle phi, initial speed V naught. You may neglect air resistance. The question is, what is the horizontal range of the stone when the stone strikes the ground? So this is the types of questions that we have in our data set. And here you can see there is a very useful diagram to complement these things. But remember, we're not yet using diagrams. So what is the technology that we are using? We're using open sourced large language models and a few diverse and clean data points. This is very important. So we took Llama. We talked about this, this range of models this morning. So we use a 13 billion parameter model Llama. And we were inspired by a recent study called LIMA, Less is More for Alignment by, again, by Meta AI. So I'm going to show you three panels here that are very important for our hypotheses. The first one is if we take a look at LIMA, which is really a fine-tuned 65 billion Llama model, it is fine-tuned on only 1,000 data points. However, these data points are diverse and clean. So the stack exchange, there is about 170 categories of stack exchange, so it's very diverse. And WikiHow, natural instructions, they're very good quality questions, but they're more, more constrained in terms of the diversity. However, if we combine all of these things, and if the paper authors additionally write their own fine-tuning data points, we get 1,000 examples that are very diverse and clean. And in the middle, you can see the incredible results one could accomplish. So they have used human evaluation, and they have compared LIMA against the state-of-the-art models. So we have Alpaca, we have DaVinci. These are open source models that one could use in order to evaluate these things. But we also have Bard, Claude, and GPT-4, which are really hidden behind an API. So when the authors ask for a given prompt, the competing model to generate response and their fine-tuned LIMA model to generate the response, they see what is the win rate. So humans give their preferences. So you can see that for these open source models, the LIMA model with just 1,000 data points for fine-tuning, it's 53% of the time the human evaluators prefer that output. And even for GPT-4, 18% of the times the output from LIMA is preferred against GPT-4. And another panel here that is very important is one may ask, okay, what if I keep on scaling the size of the data set? Here you can see that the generation quality on the y-axis doesn't actually change if we keep on increasing the number of data points. So this was very exciting to us because, of course, we have a limited set of data points. But we wanted to, as a first step of our research, to see if we can replicate similar behavior. So here I can show you some of our preliminary results. This is, the prompt is, a submarine is traveling 50 meters deep in seawater with some density. If the submarine has a volume of some cubic meters, what is the hydrostatic pressure exerted on the submarine? So if we take a baseline Lama model, it doesn't really get to the solution of the problem. Our fine-tuned model on this data point from the evaluation data set identifies the correct equation and plugs in the correct numbers. Now you can see there's a natural next step. Let's actually evaluate this expression, right? And you know, this is large language models are notorious for still struggling with simple math. So there are some exciting future work to consider here. One of them is, I believe, Stephen Wolfram is going to talk about plugins, like using a Wolfram Mathematica as a plugin to these large language models to evaluate the expressions. And we have some other ideas. I'm very happy to chat about them. But another point is, these results, they're very low on Bloom's taxonomy. So if you think about solving this particular question, it requires remembering, understanding, but we actually want to go higher on this hierarchy, hopefully in our exploration. We want to see if we can use the language model to apply knowledge, analyze, evaluate, and create. I want to also mention something technical. We were able to reproduce a very interesting finding from Lima, and something I want to open as an open problem here, evaluation. So actually, if you trace, you have a training curve, and you trace the validation curve, if you trace the perplexity, which is really the loss function that the model is using to be training on, the validation goes up as we keep on training. And this is something that the Lima paper has also discovered. But validation going up, we may think about in classical machine learning that there's some overfitting. But actually there isn't. The quality of the prompts, at least for human evaluation, becomes better with more training and higher perplexity loss in the validation set. So here, this is a big open problem about how to properly evaluate these things. And some directions for future work is we are going to scale our exploration from 13 billion to 65 billion models. We have plans to incorporate a larger context so we can facilitate dialogue. I want to conclude with some of our next steps. I'm not sure if you have played with BART recently, so this is another very exciting direction from Google, but recently they have enabled multimodal dialogues. And here I have posted a snapshot of a physical pendulum. And I asked the BART model to explain what's happening in the image and generate Python code to describe the system. You can dig into the responses, but I can tell you some very exciting things. First of all, the model learns to identify that this is a physical pendulum. It has some misunderstanding what a physical pendulum is. For example, it says, this is a pendulum that is not constrained to swing in the vertical plane. I mean, that's not really the case of what we are hoping to get in here. So this is a mistake. But as we had a discussion with Peter, mistakes are good opportunities to teach and learn and can still be incorporated in the classroom. What I want to say about is the Python code. So the Python code is actually a very accurate simulation of a pendulum, but with a point mass. So it doesn't really get the fact that there is a moment of inertia here. And the reason we're very excited about this thing is because we have diagrams in our data sets and we're not yet using them, but we could use them by creating captions from BART, for example. And I want to conclude with a promising dialogue. So we saw that BART was not perfect in the previous slide, but I continued the discussion with BART and I started nudging it, so correcting it. So for example, clearing up the definition of a physical pendulum and then trying to nudge it towards recognizing that it's a physical pendulum and not a point mass. So, and at some point BART was giving me an expression for the angular acceleration, but this expression was missing an angle, so it was missing the components, and I nudged it, and then it gave me the correct expression. So this was a very interesting conversation with BART, and I encourage you to put a screenshot of your research and see how far you can get. But to us, who are actually fine-tuning these large language models, it's an important means for generating data that we can use for fine-tuning. And I want to conclude now with this presentation. Thank you for listening. Yeah.
All right, feel free to come up to the microphones for any questions. I had one question actually for you about this model that can look at the diagrams. Can it look at diagrams and also words next to the diagrams, like the way you'd be presented a problem on a problem set? Basically, you give it both the problem and the accompanying figure.
That's a great question. Yes, it can. Yes, it can. I don't have particular examples here, but here you can see in the prompt, you're just writing out. So here I gave it a very free form of a discussion, you know, explain what's happening in this image, but in principle, it could be a very concrete problem and the diagram beside it.
Okay, I guess one quick follow-up question. Could you imagine feeding it a paper with both the text and the figures and having it interpret that all cohesively?
I think that's the holy grail, right? So it would be very exciting to do that. I can foresee a future where the multimodal large language models are going to have this capability. I think the big question is, what does it take for the model? So the capability is there, the multimodality would be there, but what does it take for a model to actually give meaningful, to go higher on the Bloom taxonomy, right? And that's something we don't know. We are researching right now. How many papers does it need to see so that you can fine tune the weights that it to give you what you want? Does it need to see 1,000 papers, or maybe 100,000 papers, the whole archive, or these are open problems, and I think they're very exciting. And I'm very certain that we'll get to explore many of these aspects in the next couple of years.
Thank you. It looks like we have a question.
So when students or just generally people try to understand and learn new concepts, they are like pretty focused on like having some sort of underlying understanding of what's going on. And as was mentioned a lot in the talks previously today, these large language models are very simply just kind of predicting the next word. Do you expect to have any like tensions between like large language models interacting with students and that the large language models don't actually have an in-depth understanding? And like, are you able to prompt the large language models to try to get them to be able to justify understanding themselves?
This is a great question. What does it mean for a large language model to have an understanding? In no way I'm an expert in that direction. I think there's probably lots of philosophical and maybe very concrete studies in that direction. But I can tell you what my personal excitement is. We had a discussion with Ike Chuang from the physics department about how can we trust these models? And one of the suggestions was, why not we quote unquote send them to MIT to take the curriculum at MIT? Because if we're here at MIT and once we take the curriculum, we have a certificate of being able to cope with certain type of research and certain type of curriculum. So this may be an exciting direction to provide more and more of the curriculum. And also, I think very crucial, because what's very important here in MIT is the tools that we have, the people that we can communicate with. So providing some ability to use software tools to make explorations, to formulate hypotheses, and recursively feed them back into into a planning machine, sort of related to Professor Kunstok. I think that's a very exciting direction, and I don't see any major roadblocks in expanding in that direction. So I think that may be a way to test whether actually a model understands something, to give it the tools and to see what it does with these tools, what kind of hypotheses it formulates and how it acts upon these hypotheses. So something related to planning, I think.